Dear students, myself, Dr. Kamlesh Gakkar, Professor in Economics from Institute of Management Studies and Research, Maharishi Dayanand University, Rohtak. In the last lecture, we discussed about the problems in the estimation of national income and importance of the national income. In today's lecture, we will discuss about nominal GDP, real GDP, potential GDP, national product and economic welfare. The objective of this lecture is to know difference between nominal GDP and real GDP, difference between actual GDP and potential GDP, and what is the relationship between national product and economic welfare. So, this lecture includes the explanation of what is nominal gross domestic product, what is real gross domestic product, conversion of nominal GDP into real GDP, GDP deflator, national product and national welfare. Rather, we will see what is the economic welfare and whether it is related to national product or not. National income is estimated by multiplying the final goods and services produced in an economy by their price. So, national income is equal to, we can see it is output multiplied by the price, or it is sigma PG. NY is the national income, sigma is the sum total, P is for price and G is the goods and services. When national product is multiplied by the current prices, we get national income or GDP at current prices. We know that prices don't remain constant, they go on changing. If prices rise, GDP at current prices will definitely increase, even if there is no increase in the volume of output produced. In an inflationary environment, there will be overstatement of the actual volume of economic activity. In case of decline in prices, GDP at market prices will fall without any reduction in the output produced in the economy. This will result in underestimation of the actual volume of economic activity. So, what is nominal national income? So, nominal income is the national income at current prices. It is the monetary value of all goods and services produced in an economy in 1 year. National income at current prices or nominal GDP does not give us a true picture of the economic performance of a country. Table 1 shows the change in nominal GDP. In the first column, we have shown the years. We have taken 2 years, 2000, 2001 and 2013-14. In commodities, we have taken wheat, cloth and sugar, and the same three commodities are produced in 2013 and 14. Quantity produced of wheat is 40 tons, cloth is 300 meters, sugar is 10 tons and price of wheat is rupees 200 per ton. So, the value added from wheat is rupees 8000. In case of cloth, price is rupees 20 per meter. So, rupees 6000 is the total value. And in case of sugar, price is rupees 600 per ton. So, value added is rupees 6000. So, by adding all this, we get the nominal GDP, that is rupees 20,000. In 2013-14, the production of wheat, cloth and sugar remains the same. It is 40 tons of wheat, 300 meters of cloth and 10 tons of sugar. But the prices of these commodities have changed. Wheat price has now increased to rupees 300 per ton. So, the value added is rupees 12,000. In case of cloth, now the price is rupees 30 per meter and value added is rupees 9,000. In case of sugar, price has increased to rupees 800 per ton. So, the value added is rupees 8,000. So, if we add the total values, it gives us rupees 29,000. It is evident from the table number 1 that there is no increase in real output during the period between 2000-2001 to 2013-14. Money value of the output or nominal GDP has increased by 45% because of increase in prices. Nominal income is the national income at current prices. So, it is known as nominal income or monetary income. National income at current prices or nominal GDP does not give us a true picture of the economic performance of a country. So, that is why we want to know what is real GDP. So, change in real GDP can be shown in the table 2. In the left hand side column, we have shown the year. Firstly, we have shown 2000 and 2001. In the second column, we have shown the commodities, wheat, cloth and sugar. 40 tons of wheat is produced. Price is rupees 200 per ton. So, the total value is rupees 8000. Quantity of cloth produced is 300 meters. Price is rupees 20 per meter. So, rupees 6000 is the value added. In case of sugar, 10 tons of sugar is produced. Price is rupees 600 per ton. So, rupees 6000 is the value added. So, the total value addition is rupees 20,000. Now, in case of the year 2013-14, wheat, cloth and sugar are being produced. Now, the production has increased. Production of wheat is now 60 tons. Production of cloth is 600 meters. Production of sugar is 20 tons. Price of wheat, cloth and sugar is the same. Price of wheat is rupees 200 per ton. Value added is rupees 12,000. In case of cloth, price is rupees 20 per meter as it was in 2000-2001. So, rupees 12,000 is the value added. In case of sugar, price has the same, that is rupees 600 per ton and total value is 12,000. By adding the value of all these three items, we get rupees 36,000. Now, in this case, only output has increased. Price is constant or price is the same. So, there has been increase in the real GDP and that is 80%. So, to make year-to-year comparisons of an economy's productive performance, we have to estimate GDP at constant prices. So, GDP at constant prices is called real GDP or real gross domestic product. So, till now we have discussed what is nominal GDP, that is the GDP at current prices, real GDP, which is the GDP at constant prices, change in nominal GDP and change in real GDP, this we have covered. Now, how we can convert nominal GDP into real GDP? Nominal GDP can be converted into real GDP or national income or GDP at constant prices with the help of index numbers. The constant prices refer to a particular year called base year. Base year price index is always taken as 100. National income at current prices is divided by the current year price index and multiplied by the base year price index. So, real GDP at constant prices is equal to GDP at current price divided by the current price index multiplied by 100. Suppose the national income is rupees 200 crore in 2001 and in 2014 it is rupees 400 crore at the current price. If the price index rose from 100 to 300 within the same period, then we can find out the national income at constant prices. Here we are showing conversion of nominal GDP into real GDP. We have taken the year 2001 and 2014. National income at current prices, in 2001 it is rupees 200 crore and in 2014 it is 400 crore. But the index number in 2001 is 100 and it has increased to 300 in 2014. So, national income at current prices in 2001 is equal to 200 divided by 100 multiplied by 100, it is rupees 200 in 2001, but in 2014 it is 400 divided by the current price index, that is 300 multiplied by the base year price index, that is 100. So, we get it as rupees 133.33. So, actually we have seen that real GDP in this case has fallen. From just looking at the figures, we could say that the income has doubled, but in reality it has fallen because we have now taken the real GDP, or which is the national income at constant prices. Now, we will see what is the GDP deflator. Real GDP can be found by dividing the nominal or national GDP by the GDP deflator. So, GDP deflator is equal to current year price index divided by the base year price index. This can also be shown symbolically. So, capital Y is equal to small y multiplied by P. So, y small y, which is our real GDP, is equal to Y capital divided by P. So, small y refers to the real GDP and capital Y is the nominal GDP, and PG and P is the GDP price deflator or GDP deflator. Nominal GDP versus real GDP, how they are completely different from each other. Nominal GDP is the total value of the newly produced goods and services computed using the prices at which they were sold during the year they were produced. In contrast, real GDP is the value of goods and services after adjusting for the effects of year-to-year price changes. Now, what is the potential GDP? Potential GDP is the amount of goods and services a country can produce in a specific period of time when it fully utilizes its productive resources efficiently. At this output, labor market is at full employment. So, actually potential GDP is that which can be achieved by making use of all types of resources which are available to a country. What can be the maximum output which a country can achieve? Full employment is a situation when all those who are willing to work at the going wage rate have got employment. Potential GDP is also called, that is why, full employment level of output. Potential GDP is actually the ideal or desired or target output. Natural rate of unemployment may be there even at the full employment level. Now, what is this natural rate of unemployment? some people don't have the skills required for jobs, so they are unemployed. On quitting one type of job, when one shifts to the other job, there is a time gap till which he remains unemployed. So, all these come under natural unemployment. Now, what are the major determinants of potential GDP? This depends upon mainly three factors: the labor force and its willingness to work. What is the available labor force? Naturally, that will decide how much output can be produced in the economy. The capital stock. What is the capital stock available in the economy about machines, equipment? How much capital we are having, that will also decide how much output can be produced in the economy. Technology of the economy is also very important determinant of potential GDP. The countries where technology is improving day by day, naturally their potential GDP is more than the countries which are having the low level of technology. Now, what is the output gap? Actual real GDP of a country is generally not equal to the potential GDP due to many inefficiencies or due to certain bottlenecks. The real GDP is different from what can be the actual GDP which can be achieved by a country by making the full utilization of resources. Now, the difference between potential and actual GDP is called the output gap. If the potential GDP is more than the actual GDP, this implies that there is scope for growth of the economy. Naturally, if you can say that if potential GDP is more, you can achieve more growth, you can have more income in the economy, but the actual income is lower than that. So, this means there is a scope for growth. We can hope to have more income in the economy if potential GDP is greater. Then policy makers can decide about what monetary policy and fiscal policy tools can be used for the fuller utilization of the resources. In Indian economy, you must have heard that there is a very large young workforce, but actually that is unemployed. So, this means potential GDP of India is more than the actual GDP because there is too much unemployment. Even our capital stock, machines are not properly utilized. There is less utilization of the plant's capacity. So, that also shows that potential GDP is more. And there are many other bottlenecks also. Because of that reason, the actual GDP comes less than the potential GDP of India. When actual GDP is more than the potential GDP, this means that there is rising aggregate demand in the economy, leading to inflationary trends in the economy. When aggregate demand goes on rising, this means people are ready to buy more and more goods in the economy. So, this leads to rise in prices, and that is the inflation in the economy. Potential GDP also does not remain constant. With the increase in labor force, capital stock and technological development, it goes on increasing. Till now, we have discussed conversion of nominal GDP into real GDP, GDP deflator, difference between nominal GDP and real GDP, potential GDP, major determinants of potential GDP and output gap. Now, what is the relationship between national product and economic welfare? To know the economic welfare of a country, we need to have a look at the national income. An improvement in per capita income is an indicator of the increased economic welfare of the people of a country. Economic welfare of different countries can be compared on the basis of per capita income of the countries. According to PIGU, economic welfare is that part of total welfare which can be expressed in monetary terms directly or indirectly. Non-economic welfare, on the contrary, is that part of total welfare which is not amenable to monetary measurement. Economic welfare alone does not serve as an index of total welfare of the country. Sometimes there is increase in the economic welfare and there is decrease in the non-economic welfare at the same time. So there is no change in the total welfare. Therefore, economic welfare is not a genuine barometer of the total welfare of the people. In many countries, including India, per capita income has increased. This means an increase in the economic welfare of the country. But rapid industrialization has adversely affected the non-economic welfare of the people. So many factors must be taken into consideration before deciding whether national income is a true indicator and reliable index of economic welfare of a country over a period of time. What points must be taken are impact of change in prices. Nominal national income increases with rise in prices and decreases with the fall in prices, even if there is no change in the output produced. So, this must be taken into consideration. Then, impact of change in population. Supposing the national income is rising, but the population is also increasing. So, the per capita income will rise only if the rise in population is proportionately less than the rise in income. So, this also should also be taken into consideration. Then, availability of consumer goods is also to be taken into consideration. If the national income rises, but the proportion of consumption goods does not rise and there is increase in the production of capital goods, war equipment, etc., this will not increase the economic welfare of the people, because people will not have the availability of consumption goods for satisfying their wants. So, per capita income may be rising, but they can't buy the goods to satisfy their wants. Rise in national income does not necessarily imply that there is rise in every man's income. We have to see what is the distribution of income. This may have created more gap between the rich and the poor. If the increase in national income goes to the rich people and does not increase the welfare of all the people. Layer hours. If people have to work for fewer hours and output remains the same, this will increase the welfare, as layer is also essential. If output rises on account of more working hours and less layer, this implies less welfare. But there is no method to measure layer and how to count that in national income. There are other factors also which affect the welfare. A number of things which are not related to the output of goods and services make the nation better off. That is, peace, improved race relations, or equal education opportunities to all, elimination of crime and violence, and improved system of courts and justice, and so on. These things increase the welfare of the people in the country. Now, impact of environment must also be seen. If there is deterioration in environment quality and there is reduction in amenities that result from producing more and more output, the costs exceed the benefits of having the greater output. Thus, it can be concluded that national income is not a true barometer of the total welfare of the nation. It is merely a rough indicator, and government can redistribute national income in favor of the poor classes by means of fiscal policy, dual pricing and rationing, etc. So, in this lecture, we have seen what is nominal GDP, what is real GDP, how we can find out change in nominal GDP, change in real GDP, what is potential GDP, what are the major determinants of potential GDP, what is output gap, and we have also seen how national product is related to the economic welfare and what factors affect the national welfare, that is the impact of change in prices, impact of change in population, availability of consumption goods. Factors affecting national welfare others are impact of distribution of income, layer hours, impact of environment. So, all these things are very important in determining the welfare of the people of a country. In the next lecture, we will discuss about aggregate demand or expenditure. Thank you.